Hi everyone, I'm Karen Schaler and welcome to Christmas Karen Behind the Story. I started this show so I could take you behind the scenes of those magical Lifetime, Hallmark, and Netflix Christmas movies that we all love so much. And during the show, I'm going to be talking to the actors, the directors, the producers, the writers, and the authors that write these stories that come into our homes and just fill our hearts at Christmas and all year long. Now, I got the nickname Christmas Karen after I wrote the Netflix hit A Christmas Prince. And then in the last 3 years, I've written 5 Christmas movies and 4 Christmas novels. And I'm super excited to share my next book with you, which is Christmas Ever After. It's coming out September 29th. It's a Mamma Mia meets the Bachelorette style love story. And of course, I'm working on the screenplay for this one as well. But what I'm most excited about today to introduce you all to is we've been talking with directors and actors, but we also have these authors. You notice a lot of the movies that comes up and it says based on a story by, based on a book by. That's because authors have this way of just creating these special stories, and no one does it better, let me tell you, than our next guest. We are so lucky to have, because she is under deadline after deadline, because she is doing some of the most amazing movies for the Hallmark Channel. We are here to introduce Teri Wilson and the newest addition to the Wilson family, her beautiful little puppy, Charm. Hi, Teri. Thanks for joining us.
Oh. Hi, Karen. Thanks so much for having us. This is Charm's debut.
Oh, she is gorgeous. She is absolutely beautiful. How old is she?
She's 9 weeks, and so she's chewing on a bone, so she does not chew on my sequins.
Well, we should talk about that, because in my other shows, I've been a little more casual, but you and I, we agreed, we're blonde, and we like our sparkle.
Right, for sure.
I mean, hello, and you're right now with me down the Christmas rabbit hole of Christmas sort of 24/7, and I want to jump in. We have a lot to talk to you about. You are a very busy girl, and so I want to jump in with what I know a lot of people are excited about. You have written novels that have been turned into Hallmark movies, which is an amazing feat in itself, because Hallmark is such a beloved brand and really goes after the heart. And they have literally thousands of stories that are pitched to them to pick from. And the fact that they have chosen 4 of yours, and then we're going to talk a little later, you're also writing novels for them.
Yes.
I mean, that says so much, Teri. I mean, honestly, we are so lucky to have you and to tell your stories. So we're going to talk about each one. The first story, and how convenient that we have a little Charm here, because it has to do with Unleashing Mr. Darcy, is one of the Hallmark fan favorites. And we know that. We love it so much. But we want to take you back from, you've written so many books, to how did it become your very first Hallmark movie, and that moment when you heard, or when you first thought there was a possibility, because that's what we're dying to hear.
Okay. Well, I love telling this story, because I did not even know it was a possibility. The book came out on New Year's Eve, December 2013. And, you know, it did okay. It didn't, you know, it wasn't a bestseller or anything like that. Mm-hmm. And my agent just told me, she said, you know, I have a plan. I just think that this book is bigger than, you know, the response is getting. Just give me time. I'm going to get this book into more people's hands. And I said, okay, you know, and I just kept going about my business. And she told me once or twice, she said, I'm working on something for Unleashing Mr. Darcy, and I really think it's going to happen, but I don't want to tell you about it yet. And of course, it was driving me insane. I had no idea. Yeah. And of course, in my wildest imagination, I never imagined it would be a film. But and she called me one day. I remember it was at 4:30 in the afternoon, just mm-hmm. in the middle of the week. And she said, Teri, I have some interesting news. And, you know, interesting. I thought it was going to be.
What does that mean?
Bad. I was like bracing myself. What is it now, you know? And she said, the Hallmark Channel has optioned Unleashing Mr. Darcy. I mean, I could have fallen off of my sofa. I was so shocked. And I was already a huge Hallmark fan before this even happened. So that's why this has been such a fun ride for me, because I've always been, you know, the girl who watches all the Hallmark Channel movies, you know, especially at Christmas, but all the other ones. And so I just couldn't, I mean, I immediately burst out crying, because I mean, I still cry just thinking about it, because I was just so shocked and so overwhelmed that something like that, you know, would happen to me. I just never even imagined. And, you know, and she was saying, you know, I've been going, you know, we found out about a week ago, but I've been going back and forth on some things. And I was like, what are you talking about? I would have done it for free, you know, which is why I haven't.
Right, exactly. We all say that. We're always like, shh, just take that, rewrite. But we know, exactly. Because when it's a story you're so passionate about, and you have these characters, the thought of bringing it to life. But explain for the people watching, there's a big difference between we have the Hallmark optioning it and the Hallmark making it. So tell about that journey.
So that was one of my first questions, because I mean, I know that most things that get optioned do not get made, just in the general, you know, entertainment world. And she did tell me that, you know, Hallmark takes such a long time to decide for sure if they want to option something, that when they option something, there's a good chance that it will actually get made, but that there was a lot of waiting. So, you know, my Hallmark story, which is, I think, everyone else's Hallmark story, who's, you know, we wait and wait and wait and wait, and everything happens overnight instantaneously after like 9 months of waiting. So we waited and we waited, and, you know, while they worked on the script and that sort of thing. And then I remember my agent called me in October. And I was at my favorite cupcake bakery where I like to go and write. And I was sitting there and she called me and she said, it's a go. It's happening. We're filming it next month and it's going to air in January. And I was like, what? I mean, I didn't even know you could make a movie that fast, you know?
Right.
So yeah. And it was my first, you know, like I said, it was my first time, you know, ever having a film even, or especially working with Hallmark. Oh, wait, I dropped the puppy bone. Just a minute.
Oh no, we can't have that. Hold on. Who knows what charm will do? That sequence is awful tempting.
That's what she would do. what was I saying? Oh, the options.
You were saying,
So, I didn't know that you could make a movie that fast. Yeah. And since it was my first Hallmark movie, I hadn't met my producer before. I'd never been on set. I wasn't, you know, as plugged in kind of as I am now, because I've had the same executive producer for all my films. And we know each other really
well. We're going to talk about that. Yeah.
Yeah, we know each other really well now. We did not at the time. And so I was kind of out of the loop at the beginning. Yeah. And I first started seeing the actors, or, you know, different people working on the film, posting things on social media. Yeah. And so I was stalking my own movie, like trying to figure out what was going on. But then, you know, I got invited to go to set, and then, you know, I got plugged in and I got to see, you know, who was in it. And, you know, when you sell a book to become a movie, then it's no longer your story, you know, and they can change whatever they want. I've been really lucky because I've, you know, loved everything that Hallmark has done with any of my books. They've changed things here and there, and it's always been for the best. I mean, it's been, you know, to make it a better movie. But my, you know, my initial reaction was, because that book is very near and dear to my heart, because the dogs were based on my own dogs, you know, Cavalier King Charles Spaniels. And so I started getting really worried that they were going to change the dog to a different dog. I mean, I love all dogs, but because they were named after my dogs, because the dog in the movie is named Bliss, she was named after my dog Bliss, who just passed away last month, actually. I was just, you know, and it all came out perfectly. I mean, the dogs were perfect, the actors were perfect, and it was just, it was the most fun ride ever. And I still love that it is such a fan favorite at Hallmark.
Absolutely.
It's such a personal movie to me.
Well, and I think that's so important, because that's something I wanted to share that I learned. I did things a little backwards, where I wrote Christmas Camp, the movie, first. But I had a similar situation where after I wrote the movie that was very close to my heart, and then I handed it off to the director, the producers, the actors, as the writer of a screenplay, I was done. And it was like, wait a minute, you know, I mean, that's collaboration, and that's what it's all about. But that's why I said, I want to write the book, and then I have more to tell, and I'm going to do Christmas Camp Wedding. And so while they were producing my Christmas Camp movie, I was writing the novel so they could come out at the same time. And then I would have, you know, like, that's why you have sequels to yours. There's the wedding, right? So I thought, I'll have that too. But it was because I had such a love for my story, and I respect, even as a screenwriter, you're not often involved in that, because the director has to make it theirs. The network has to make it theirs. The actors bring their own life and their own story to it. But at first it's hard, you know, and I was the same, because I had a dog in mind, and I had a certain breed of dog, but it wasn't as personal as yours was to yours. And your story is so specifically. And I think that at first you're so nervous. And even me as a screenwriter, I wrote the screenplay and the book, and I was still nervous to see the movie, because, you know, you just don't know. And I did not get to go on the set of my movie because it was shot really fast and a lot of things happened. So I was doing the same. I was stalking, in a good way, the actors. Oh, that looks cute. Oh, there's my house, because I didn't have any part of that. And I want to go next to that, because that is an honor, you know, to be able to go on a set, because there are people, and it's not just Hallmark. I've done now Hallmark, Lifetime, Netflix. And some people can't have a writer on set for a lot of different reasons. But you not only are on set, young lady, but I was the other day going, wait, is that Teri in the, you have cameos in the movie. So first of all, let's back up on the first time on set, because I don't want to get too ahead of ourselves. And I want you to summarize Unleashing Mr. Darcy for the people that haven't had an opportunity to see us. Tell us what that story is about.
Okay. Unleashing Mr. Darcy is a modern day version of Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice set in the dog show world. And it sounds a little nutty and crazy when I describe it, but it works. I hope.
It totally works.
That's what it is. And so Mr. Darcy is the dog show judge, and Elizabeth Scott, you know, who's based on Jane Austen's iconic Elizabeth Bennet, is showing her dog, you know, in the dog show under Mr. Darcy. And she's just really intimidated by him because he's, you know, mean and scary and yet, you know, broodingly handsome at the same time.
Of course.
Eventually she ends up taking a job like kind of as a dog nanny. So that is the basis of that story.
And those two actors did an amazing job with that, your story,
Right? Yeah, Ryan Pavey and Cindy Busby, yeah. They're great. And I just, you know, that was Ryan's first Hallmark movie. And I just thought the casting was perfect. He was the perfect Mr. Darcy. So
I didn't realize that was his first, because I've seen him on a lot since that. And he was, because he had, of course, he's so handsome, but he has this way and this air about him that he, of course, that's acting too. But I thought they both were cast so perfectly. And tell us where they get the dogs, because those dogs were adorable and not easy to just grab some, you know, dogs. I felt fit your description so well in your book.
Oh, yeah, thank you. So I thought that they were great too. And of course, now I've made friends with all the people who had the dogs. So most of the dogs, you know, because they were at a dog show. So there were a lot of other dogs besides just Elizabeth's dog. Most of those dogs are actually Canadian show dogs. Mm-hmm. I think they put out a call for dog, because, you know, the movie was filmed in Canada, as a lot of Hallmark movies are. And so they put out a call for some, you know, Canadian dog show dogs to be in the movie. And they all showed up. So most of them are Canadian, actually dogs that compete in dog shows. The dog that played Bliss belonged to a family who had birds that are in a lot of movies. You know, there's a talent agency that I think their name is the Woodleys. It's a family, and they train animals to be in different movies. They had some birds that had worked with the Woodleys before. Yeah. And when the producer asked the Woodleys, they said, you know, we need a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, you know, to be one of the lead dogs in this movie. They just said, oh, I think one of our bird families actually just has a Cavalier as a pet. And so Bliss belonged to them. So she was not technically a show dog. I mean, most of the dogs that she was competing against in the movie were. But the dog that played Bliss, whose name was Tika, she has since passed away. She belonged to, you know, a family that had worked with showbiz birds before.
Yeah. This is why behind this story, this is why I did this. You know, there's so many, and to be able to hear these stories, I mean, these are new to me too, Teri. I love this. Now, tell me about the first time you're invited on set, because again, like I said, that is an honor and a privilege.
Oh, well, that was a result of me begging really badly.
Good. So maybe that's a tip. If you don't ask, you don't get, right?
You know,
if you don't
ask, you don't get. I'm a firm believer in that. We're going to talk about tips later. Yes. And I'm a firm believer in know what you want and ask for it, because it's never a yes if you don't tell people what it is that you want. So that was, that was my first question when I found out that I was actually definitely having a movie. I asked my agent, I said, can I go on set, please? I mean, that was more important to me than anything because I thought, you know, this is insane. I can't believe this is happening to me. It's never going to happen again. You know, I have to go on set, please. And she said, I don't know. You know, it's tricky. Sometimes it doesn't work. And I mean, I wasn't obnoxious about it, but I did ask about it for a couple days because it was really important to me.
Absolutely.
So then, yes, the producer said that I could come on set. I swore. I said, I won't make a peep. I won't say a word. You'll never know that I'm there. Totally hide. And they finally let me, they flew me up there, and it was for a couple days during the big climax scene, you know, where, the black moment where the villain shows up at the big fancy ball.
We won't tell any spoiler alerts, of course.
No spoilers. But they had told me, you know, to dress extremely casually, because I needed
to. But yeah. Teri, casual. I'm sorry. I'm already seeing something happening here because I don't see this working. We didn't mention, and we will get into. I love, and you read the bio, and it says you love royals and tiaras. Like, you know, just like I like t-shirts, you like tiaras. So keep going. I'm just curious how this casual thing went here.
Well, I had to buy tennis shoes. That's how bad it was. I mean, my friends were like, "Do you own tennis shoes?" I was like,
No.
But I mean, I wanted to buy cute ones because I was going to be on a movie. But we were filming in a very fancy house, and there were a lot of rules. They didn't want people wearing, you know, spiked heels, or, you know, or whatever, you know, on the floor. We were trying to be very respectful of the space where we were filming. So they were just, you know, be really casual, wear just like leggings and tennis shoes, and it's really cold and damp. So, and we did a lot of filming outside the first day, and then we were inside. So, I mean, I was wearing leggings and like a swing type sweater. I mean, it was cute, but I was really casual. Yeah. And I had been outside in November, you know, in November in Canada for half a day. My hair was a frizzy mess.
Yeah.
And then the director just looked at me and said, "Hey, do you want to be in your movie, Teri?" And I was like, "Yes." But I mean, it kind of looked like a mess, but I was in it. You know?
Yeah, that's amazing. Well, I love that. And again, just by being there, the opportunity, I wasn't able to be on the set for Christmas camp, but my next movie I did, which was called Every Day is Christmas with Toni Braxton, I was invited on set. And that was a different experience because I wrote it from an idea with Toni and the executive producer, and I got to see it every step of the way. My other ones were a spec where the movie was already done and then I gave it, you know, so they didn't need me anymore. Right. It was done. Yeah. But this way, and learning and getting to go on set, I actually got to take my mom and Toni, who was playing the Scrooge in this. She's such an amazing actor, but she was in every single scene because she's Toni Braxton and we want to see her in every single scene. But she still took the time to take a picture with my mom. And of course, you know, you'd never ask that when you're on set because it's not cool. It's a working set and they're, you know, shooting these things in a couple weeks. She'd come on set and see my mom, go, "Hi, Mom." And I mean, she was so kind, you know, and I learned so much. I was like a peep, like staying away because it's work. This isn't a vanity come and enjoy, especially the Hallmark Lifetime movies where they're shooting so fast. Right. And I learned more by being on the set and watching my words come alive and seeing the actors play the roles that I had made. I mean, I still get goosebumps thinking about it. And I remember one of the Lifetime executives was there with me, Chris Wade, and we were watching a scene behind the director, and he went like this, you know, for goosebumps. And I was like, I was still sort of in this world of I couldn't believe this was happening. So how was it, a novel that was your baby and a very personal story, you know, close to your heart, seeing it come to life for you when you were on set and being there as part of it?
Oh my gosh, it was insane. And, you know, I was so, you know, I guess I'm a pretty emotional person. I mean, I'm a romance novelist. So yes,
right, of course.
I have squishy feelings. So, but I was just so overcome by it because I was so excited and so overwhelmed that I couldn't believe it was happening. That, I mean, I cried every day before I left to go on set. Like I would get on social media and I would see one of the actors or actresses post a photo from the set. And I would just be like, "Oh, it's so beautiful." You know, I'd start crying. So I remember talking to my husband before I left. I said, you know, I need to get a grip on my emotions before I get there. Cause I don't want to be just like weeping on set. People will think I'm crazy. So I was trying really hard to just, you know, keep it together and just tell everyone how excited I was. But without, you know, outright, but, you know, falling into tears. So I had been on set like 2 days. I think it was the third day because it was right before I was leaving to go home. So I get there and I had made friends now with people, you know,
of course.
The script supervisor and the producer, especially, you know, I spent most of the day with them sitting next to them, you know, watching everything through the monitor. So I get to set on the third day and they said, "Teri, we have a surprise for you." And I was like, "Okay, what is it?" And they like unveiled it and they had gotten me a chair that said Unleashing Mr. Darcy with my name on it.
No.
Yes, it had the name of the movie and my name and then it said author underneath it. And I immediately burst out crying. I was just like, I could not like to be cool with it, you know?
So, oh my God, but that's because you have such a big heart, Teri. And that's why the stories you tell resonate so well with the Hallmark audience and all audience. The love that you have and that genuine, that's why we love you. I mean, that's real. That's what's up.
It got really embarrassing because I was crying. I said, "Oh my gosh, this is so great." And they said, oh, and guess what? You can take it home with you. And I was like, really? And so I said, well, I'm not sure how I'm going to be able to get on the plane, you know, folding it. Maybe I can put it in the overhead bin. And they were like, not the whole chair, just the placard on the back.
I would have done the same thing. I'd have been like, as soon as you said that, I'm like, how is she going to get the chair on the plane?
I was a total newbie to a movie set. I had no idea. But now I have the placard framed and hanging on my wall in my dining room. So I do still have it.
I love that. And then, so you did this magical moment. You create this story and this, you're living a dream, right? This was a dream come true. You grew up watching this, but then it happened again. So tell me what happened. That lightning strikes twice.
I know. Well, it was crazy because I do remember being on the set of Unleashing Mr. Darcy, you know, all the people that I had met, they kept saying, oh, you know, the first one is the most special. They kept talking about the first one. And I kept thinking, y'all are nuts. I mean, I can't imagine this ever happening, you know, again. But Unleashing Mr. Darcy did really well. When it came out, the ratings were great.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It also had a big splash on social media. So I think that Hallmark then was really interested in, you know, taking a second look at everything else that I had. So right after that, they immediately optioned two more things, boom, boom, like right afterwards.
And what were they? Tell us again. What were they? The next one?
The Art of Us, which came out as a movie under that same name, starring Taylor Cole and Steve Lund. And then the other one was a book that I wrote called Sleigh Bell Sweethearts. That originally Hallmark had looked at it and passed because of reindeer logistics.
right. I was going to say, I love that reindeer so much.
The book has 31 more reindeer in it. And they were just like, that's too many reindeer. So at first they passed. But then after Darcy did so well, they wanted to look at it again. And they said, well, we'll figure out the reindeer thing. So that book was called Sleigh Bell Sweethearts. But when the movie was made, it was changed to Northern Lights of Christmas. That's the name. And it was on Hallmark Movies and Mysteries Channel, starring Ashley Williams and Corey Sevier.
And then we're missing, but the Darcy, we had to have more.
Right. Well, I mean, they optioned those two right away. And we immediately started pitching ideas for a Darcy sequel. But it took a really long time. I mean, it took over, you know, a year and a half, maybe even 2 years to finally get the green light for the Darcy sequel. And I was on vacation with one of my writer friends in Spain. We had just taken like a girls' trip. And my agent called me really late one night in Spain. And as soon as we got to Spain, I got really sick and lost my voice. Oh. So I could barely talk. And so I'm just trying to croaking to my agent in the phone. And then she told me, and I was trying to scream, you know, like, and
you're like, nothing's coming out there. Now you'd pitch the idea, but you hadn't written the book yet, right? So, or had you had this
sequel? There's no book for the sequel. There is no book.
Yeah.
No, it's based on my characters, obviously.
Yes, and obviously. So that's how you, because you have, and we should, I like, this is behind the story. It's good for authors watching. I have the same with my books, that you option your first book, but if they make any movie, any sequels with your characters, it's still based because you created it. It's your world. It's your characters. It's your story. But did you ever think of going back and writing the novel like I did? Like the movie's made and you can write the novel?
I wanted to do that very badly, but due to some contractual things, I was not able to do that. So, you know, there's always weird rules and stuff. So
and especially working with a brand like Hallmark, they have very specific rules and all of that. But I'm so glad because it is one of the highest rated movies. We love that movie and to have the sequel. But I want to talk really quick about The Art of Us because I connected with that so much. And I love that it was just it was a different story. It was fresh. Mm-hmm. It was something that I hadn't felt like I'd seen on Hallmark. Plus, it also has a cute little dog. So just tell us the synopsis of that story.
Okay. Yeah. And I can't wait to talk about that dog because that's an interesting story. So the book and the movie are called The Art of Us. And when I wrote Unleashing Mr. Darcy, it was kind of in the same series of books. I did a series of books that were all inspired by stories in classic literature. So The Art of Us is really kind of based on like a Pygmalion, My Fair Lady mm-hmm. type story, but I have like, it's like a gender flip. So instead of Dr. Henry Higgins, who tries to make a lady out of Eliza Doolittle, mm-hmm. the professor is Dr. Harper Higgins, and she's a woman, and she's played by Taylor Cole. And so basically what she, and she's an art history professor at a university, and she's trying to get tenure. And so one of her, she's in competition with another professor to try and get tenure. So she decides to put on a big art show at the school to try and give her that extra edge. And at the last minute, her artist pulls out of the show. So she has no show. Well, she finds out that her dog walker is a really talented painter. Like she had no idea. She finds out he can paint. And so she decides to hire him to be the big famous artist in her show and try and make people believe that he's a descendant of Vincent van Gogh.
What I loved about this. And she didn't do it because, you know, in our Hallmark movies, we can't have a sneaky heroine. Right. It was an honest mistake. It was an honest mistake because there was a connection without telling too much of the story, but that was so fun and fresh. And I love Taylor Cole in this. I mean, they both, what an amazing job. But tell me about their little, what was his name? I'm sorry. I forgot the little dog.
His name was Vincent after Vincent Van Gogh.
Yes. Oh, of course. Of course. of course.
Yeah. So, and actually Vincent was played by a female border terrier that obviously had super big range to play a border terrier.
Totally. But,
the dog in that movie that played Vincent was also an Unleashing Mr. Darcy. Because there were several border terriers in Unleashing Mr. Darcy, because when Elizabeth gets a job as a dog nanny, those are the dogs that she's helping take care of an old family friend.
Yes.
And so that Unleashing Mr. Darcy, the dog's name is Rose in real life. Yeah. I mean, her name was Rose in Unleashing Mr. Darcy. So Unleashing, and the dog's name is Gidget in real life. Unleashing was Gidget's very first movie role ever. Ooh. And she works with the Woodleys, that family, as the animal, you know, the animals that are in films. So, but Gidget's first role was Unleashing Mr. Darcy. So then she went on to star in The Art of Us, and she was great. I mean, she was
totally great. Oh my God, so
but
cute.
Then she booked a major motion picture. That dog was in that movie Wonder with Tremblay and Owen Wilson.
Yes.
Yeah. So that is Gidget. And
you gave her, you gave Gidget your start. Oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. See, that's what I love. That dog, it just pulled at my heartstrings, and talk about range. I mean, it is so cute. And I was trying to think, don't all of you have the four movies now with Hallmark, don't they all have dogs? No, reindeer. We switched the dog for a reindeer Northern. Yeah.
And the Sleigh Bell Sweethearts, which is the book that Northern Lights and Christmas is based on, actually has a reindeer herding dog in it that helps, you know, take care of the reindeer. But that was just a lot, you know, for Hallmark.
I know how that is. Yeah. As it is, I have a dog. I had a dog in my Christmas camp, Hallmark movie Max, but you have to really show that the dog earns it. You know, you can't just throw in a dog because it's complicated having a dog. And I remember my Toni Braxton movie, I have this adorable little girl. And I remember the executive producer saying, you know how expensive it is to have a kid on set? This kid better earn it. And I'm like, trust me, wait till you read it. And she did. And she was amazing. But there's a lot going on. And when you're only shooting these in maybe 2 to 3 weeks, you have to really kind of pick your battles. And that's a great segue, because I want everyone, and we're going to put up Teri's website, and we're going to let people know, because you've written so many romance novels. You've won awards. Well, first, I want you to talk about that award, because first of all, I have this beautiful shot of you in your gown. That is a huge honor. That's like winning when I won an Emmy in my news industry. The award you won, and just talk about that organization, because I know that's close to your heart.
Oh, sure. The award was called the RITA Award, and it's from the Romance Writers of America, which is the biggest romance trade organization in the world. I mean, you don't have to be American to, you know, it's a worldwide, the contest is worldwide, and so is the organization. So, you know, one of my big career goals has been to win a RITA Award, and I was nominated for two at the first year, which was the year before last. And I had never been nominated before. And all of a sudden I got nominated for two, and I was so excited. And again, I was just so excited. I mean, it really truly is an honor to be nominated.
Absolutely. It is.
So, you know, I was so excited to be nominated. I didn't win either one that year, but I had the best time that night. And as we know, I love to dress up.
Yes.
So it was just fun getting all dressed up and being with my friends. And it was just the best night. And then I got nominated again the next year for one book. And it ended up winning, and it was
amazing.
I had such a good time, and I had I hadn't written a speech until that very day. And I just started thinking, you know, maybe I should just jot a few things down in case.
Just in case. Right. Yeah.
Well, because they also have another award called the Golden Heart. And the Golden Heart is for pre-published authors who do not have books out yet. And so they submit, you know, unpublished manuscripts.
Right.
So Golden Heart Award is like a luncheon. And then they have more of the conference. And then in the evening, they have the big black tie RITA Awards.
Yeah.
So I had attended the Golden Hearts and one of my friends was nominated and we sat together. And everyone who won was so eloquent and had all these moving speeches. And I thought, oh man, just in case I better write something.
Have something. Yeah.
And so I did. And then I won and I was just shaking. I was so excited. And I had my speech I had written them on the notepad in the hotel room.
Yeah. Like the little by the phone. Yeah.
So there was like 8 pages or whatever. And so when I just kind of scrambled to pick up my speech before I walked up to the stage, and I'm sure you have the picture, I was wearing a really big, poofy black ball gown.
Beautiful.
I had to go up like steps.
Stairs.
To get
oh, no.
Feet, and I could not go up the steps. I couldn't see my feet. And so I'm just like, grabbing all the tulle and trying to like see where I was stepping. Yeah. I saw a video of it afterwards because it seemed like all of a sudden I could get up there. I could hear people laughing because I couldn't get up.
Yeah, right.
But my editor was behind me because your editor gets an award too.
Yeah. Like,
oh, you get a big statue and your editor gets a plaque. So my editor was behind me, like scooping
helping
my drink.
You.
But with all that going on, I had dropped my speech. And when I picked it up, it was all in the wrong order.
Different, of course.
Yeah. And so I ended up thanking my dogs before I thanked my editor.
I love it.
But everyone loved that speech. And for the whole rest of the conference, everyone kept saying, great speech. I mean, they thought it was hilarious. But I was just really like flustered. And I was like, well, that's actually my personality. So I'm glad
you liked it. But that's genuine. And that's like when we wanted to do this show and, the executive producer along with me on the show, name's Denise Naughton, and she and I did newscast. She's done national shows working out of Manhattan. We put together and we've been both blessed to win Emmys, so we have this like real, high production value. And now with everything that's been going on in the world with COVID and the challenges, when this was inspired by some Christmas campers, when I brought my Hallmark movie and books to life and did this Christmas camp, I would do these Christmas Karen chats. And the Christmas campers, I'd basically stand up there and say, ask me anything about writing a movie. And they all are Hallmarkies. And they all want to know about Hallmark and Lifetime and Netflix. Mm-hmm. They reached out during this really challenging time and said, can you do the chats? Can you do something viral? Can you do something to share your inspiration and stories? And I thought, we all know I can talk up a blue streak, but I have some friends. I have some friends that are even cooler. And they write the movies and they're authors and they're directors. And I'm going to bring you all on, to do this and to inspire. And we wanted it to be the best production value. But at the end of the day, it's just everything's very real right now. We want to be authentic. And that's why they connected with your speech. And like, I'm here in Scottsdale, Arizona, and this is a backdrop. I'm by myself, self-isolating. And it's like a 10-foot by, it's not a green screen for people thinking it is. And I'm trying to take it out of a box and do iron. I don't know. And if you've ever like a shower curtain, I liken it to, but imagine 10 feet by 10 feet and trying to put up a pole that falls and the other, and I'm like, but the point is, it's like, I just wanted to try to bring some magic and make it real, whether it's microphones, I'm shooting this off of my iPhone, So because all my camera gear that I normally use is in New York where I usually am full time, but I'm not right now. But the response has been amazing because people just want real. And it brought me back when I watched The Voice. I don't know if you watch. And I watched Kelly Clarkson and it was in the finale. And she's such a doll too, right? Like she just gets dressed up and looks phenomenal. And she just looked regular, real, gorgeous too, right? Just almost hardly any makeup. And I connected with that so much more than if she'd been in a ball gown and had hair and makeup done. Because I'm like, that's real. She's at home, she's talking to people, and that's your speech. And that's why people love you. And that's why your books have resonated. And that's a perfect segue into, of course, you have a new book coming out this year and no coincidence that it's called Christmas Charm. So tell me about this story. We can't wait.
Oh, I am so excited for this book to get out there. It's for Hallmark Publishing. Hallmark Channel has their own publishing company.
Yes. Now,
written a few novelizations of Hallmark movies for them. But this is my first original fiction book for Hallmark Publishing. And of course it's Christmas. I mean, you know, the white whale. I just really wanted a Christmas book.
Of course.
And it's called Christmas Charms. It's told in first person point of view. It has it has a lot of humor in it. I think that readers will really like that because it's really fun. And it's about the heroine works at a fancy jewelry store in New York City, maybe based on Tiffany's and, you know, Tiffany.
Maybe.
She's from a teeny tiny town in upstate New York, but she has all these, you know, big city dreams. She's been there really pursuing, you know, a career in the city. She likes to design jewelry on the side, but doesn't get to do that at her job. She sells charms in the charms department. A couple snafus happen at the beginning. I don't want to say what they are because I don't
want to. Yes, of course not. Yes.
But she ends up having to go home to her small town for the first time in like 5 years for Christmas. And on the way, she meets a mysterious stranger on the train who gives her a charm bracelet. And when she tries it on, it gets stuck. She can't get it off her wrist. It's stuck on her wrist. She can't get it off. And one by one, all the charms on the bracelet start coming true.
Oh, I love this premise so much.
That's
What inspired you? Do you have a charm bracelet? What inspired you?
I do. Well, I'm a big fan of Tiffany and Company.
Of course.
I have like three, I think, Tiffany charm bracelets, and I have one that's all Christmas. And I've always wanted to do a story that had a touch of magic in it. I've never written anything like that before. And so that was the thing. I was trying to think of an original idea that I hadn't seen done before, but that had a touch of that Christmas magic in it. And, but just because I love charm bracelets so much, I thought, you know, I don't know, the idea just came to me.
Yeah. And as they say, write what you know, write what you're, and we'll get to that with your tips, write what you're passionate. Now tell me for the people watching, because I know there's a lot of authors that would love to, you know, be considered for a Hallmark book and a novel, and of course have their novels adapted as well. But let's stay in the lane of what you're talking about, this being your first original for Hallmark. And they've just opened their publishing company a few years ago. What advice would you give specific, even though we have more general advice coming up, because it's challenging. I mean, I'll give my one advice really quick for Hallmark, Lifetime, and Netflix is do the homework, know the brand. Because before I wrote anything, I also grew up watching all the Hallmark movies. I mean, with my family, it's part of my family tradition. But I literally would write down at 18 minutes is the first act break. The first near miss kiss is here. Like I studied it like an investigative reporter. So I knew the brand, you know, and when I've gone in and talked to Hallmark, that's what they said. They said, you'd be shocked at how many people don't know our brand. And they pitched to us. Now you have a relationship, so you're in a really unique situation where people know you, they love your writing, but what advice would you give to try and break in if you have a Christmas story, you know, to try and get into that Hallmark publishing, which is such of the Christmas world.
Yes, right? I just am so excited about it coming out. I would say the same thing. I would say read the books that Hallmark Publishing has come out. Mm-hmm. That's the number one most important thing, because I totally understand with what you're saying, because I mean, people know that I work with Hallmark. It's a big part of my brand as an author, because I sometimes live tweet the movies, like not even my movies, just like other Hallmark movies, just because it's fun and I love it. And so I get a lot of people, you know, other authors, people coming up to me saying, oh, I have a great idea for a Hallmark book. And then they'll proceed to tell me about it. And I'm thinking, no,
that's not Hallmark. Yeah,
right. Exactly. Because it's not, you know, Hallmark, it's very sweet and heartwarming. Not just as far as, you know, heat level, that sort of thing, but just as far as being light and joyful and happy. I mean, that's what Hallmark is really looking for. So, and of course they have some more, you know, heart tugging type things that can be more serious. But so my advice would, you know, Hallmark Publishing has a bunch of books out. Some are based on movies and some are not. Mm-hmm. And I would just say really, really read their books. Yeah. To really get an idea. And of course, on their website, they have submission guidelines for authors on how to submit a story.
And to that, and back to Christmas Charms, I want you to tell me when it's coming out, and I want to share your social media. We can do it now and at the end of the show as well, because I know you're going to be actively, I don't know, are you doing giveaways, or give us just a sneak into what you'll be doing to help launch this book, because we're so excited.
Yeah. Specifically, I can't really say specifically yet, but yes, I'm already posting all sorts of stuff. And of course, my biggest promo item for Christmas Charms is
Of course. Look at Charm. I know. And every anybody is going to want. I was wondering where he was. I didn't know if he'd gone
he's
back down.
He's in the lap. Yeah.
Wait, I think he should be. Have you ever thought of your dogs being cast? Because how do you have a dog sitting there for a half hour? He's such a good little girl. She is such a good little girl.
She really is good. You know, my dogs are good. I mean, they're spoiled, but they're good.
My goodness.
So, yeah, no, I have not been brazen enough yet to ask if my dogs can be in my movie. But
well,
watching, please let me put my dogs in my movie.
Exactly, right? If anyone's hearing me, because they're so well behaved. Well, and here's one thing. And Christmas Charms is coming out in October.
October 6th. Mm-hmm.
And as if that wasn't enough, we're not just ending our Christmas season there. You have a second novel that you're putting out. Or actually, let me have you tell you about it, because it's really unique. I started looking at it. I'm like, this is so fun.
Well, you know, and actually the other book is, it's called Christmas Actually, and it is kind of one of my promotional tools to help promote Christmas Charms. You know, I have a lot of author friends, and Christmas is a really fun time of year to have books come out. And so I knew that I had other author friends who have Christmas books coming out this year. And I thought, you know, wouldn't it be great if we all came together and helped each other? Because I know a lot of writers who write for Hallmark. Yeah. I know a lot of authors who write for other publishing companies, but it's Hallmarky type stories,
you right, know, exactly.
You know, would appeal to the Hallmark audience. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, if I know my readers would love them, and I know their readers would maybe like what I write. And so, I mean, I started planning this October of last year, actually. Wow. I got 10 of my friends together, and we decided to come out with our own book. We're publishing it, you know, ourselves. Yeah. I named my publishing company after my departed dog. It's Pretty Bliss Press.
I love that.
So we're each writing a short story or novella, and we're all putting them in one book together. And it's called Christmas Actually. They're all fun, lighthearted, romantic comedies, like short stories or novellas. And we're doing it so that, you know, our readers can discover, you know, our writer friends.
Each other. It's amazing. Talk about giving back. That's exactly what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. And so Nancy Nagel is one of the authors. She's had, I think, three Hallmark movies. Yeah. And we have Lacey Baker, who's written books for Hallmark Publishing, as well as Shirley Jump, who's also written for Hallmark Publishing. And then we have a bunch of other authors who there's one in particular named Victoria Shade. She's kind of a newer author. I think she's had two books out. She's a professional dog trainer, and all of her books have really cute dog story, you know, dog themes in them.
Yes. So
there are a bunch of really, you know, great authors. And so we're putting it out for just 99 cents because we just basically want people to discover we want to expand our readership and share
absolutely
our friends with our readers. And so it comes out December 1st. And until it comes out, it's only 99 cents.
And see, that is amazing. Will it be an ebook and trade, or how will it come out?
What format? Right now, it's only as an ebook, but we will be doing print. I know that Karen, you and I share the same website designer.
Yes, we do.
Yes. She is doing all the heavy lifting on this project.
Oh my goodness, Jay. Poor Jay.
I know.
She is so phenomenal. She and her amazing. Her creative and she does so much. I know, and she's so good with social media. We almost don't want to tell people about her because she's so amazing, right?
she designed our cover, which I love. It's hard to design a cover when you have to have a lot of names on it. So
absolutely.
So she is going to be putting together the print version for us. We just haven't gotten to that stage yet, since it doesn't come out till December 1st.
But I love it.
Yesterday, yeah.
Well, I think what's so special about it, I feel like right now during this time, we're all trying to find, and I don't know how it was with you, Teri, but I was writing three different Christmas projects, and I'm very blessed that I haven't got those writer's blocks. Maybe because I've been in news where I have to tell a story every day for so long that I train my brain. But when this pandemic hit and was so much that was sadness and everything in the world, it's been hard. And so to go forward with my books, I was very blessed to have my first three books optioned by HarperCollins. And that was Christmas Camp, Christmas Camp Wedding, the novella, and Finding Christmas. And then for my next book, Christmas Ever After, it went up for auction as well. And I was offered 4 book deals, 3 book deals, 5 book deals. And in a long story short, I decided to self-pub and to start my own publishing company, which is called Hocktail Publishing. Hocktail, T-A-L-E, one word. I also have a special story behind that. Save that for another show. but I did it so I could have the control and be nimble, because as a screenwriter, you know, traditional publishing can take 18 months.
Right.
And if I know I have a movie coming out, it might get greenlit and then there's 4 months until the movie. I wanted to have the ability to have the companion novels. When I wrote Christmas Camp, the novel, the idea was writing Christmas Camp Wedding, that it would come out right after. So when you watch the Hallmark movie, you didn't have to wait a year or two or three if there was a sequel, if it was even made. You would know what happens with Christmas Camp Wedding. You would have the story continue. That was the plan. And so same with my company, which I love that, you know, I didn't know that you were doing it that way, because I know for me, I wanted to also give back. And that's why I'm giving a percentage of every sale, because I can do that. You know, in a regular top and the big five, and I love the top big five, called top five, big five publishers. And I'm probably going to be a hybrid, because as I continue to do some summer romance, I have had some amazing offers to partner with different publishers there. And I believe in that, you know, and everything that that brings. But I also believe in taking it inside yourself. And I did a special program with Ingram, where I was very lucky to get accepted into a very unique program where I'm able to distribute and still find my fan base, but I get to have the control of when it comes out and to do things like what you're doing, and also to give back to the libraries and bookstores. So I think it's really empowering those of us that have been blessed to have traditional publishing deals to also find a way to give back, because you are giving so much and your other authors are giving so much to readers. And it's such a great publicity to help show each of you, but really it's a gift. I mean, 99 cents, what a perfect stocking stuffer if it's coming out in the beginning of December. You know, you can have your little, you can have your little gift card that, you know, so they can download their ebook. I mean,
yes.
I just want to say thank you. I'm excited. I can't wait to read it. I think that's genius. So I think that there's so many things that you're doing to pay it forward. And that's one of the reasons I invited you on. You're such an amazing author. Your stories we love. But now we want to go behind your story and we want you to give us some tips. There's a lot of aspiring authors. There's a lot of authors that would love their movies to be adapted, whether it be Hallmark or others. That's why we try to share these stories. So I love your first tip that you told me, and I was kind of looking at your tips, and of course they remind me of mine because we're authors. And I like it because you said, be prepared for the ups and downs. Because when we first talked to you, it sounds like, oh my gosh, look at it. You're gorgeous. You're wearing sparkle. You have the cutest dog in the world. You have four Hallmark, you know, projects and new books. It looks like your life is perfect. And we all know that's not how it is for anyone. So tell me about the tip of be ready for the ups and downs.
Right. Yes, I'm glad we're talking about this, because I remember talking to one of my other author friends who's an established author, and we're really, it's my girlfriend who went to Spain with me that time.
Yeah.
Her name is Julia London. She's a really well-known historical author. And I said, I made a comment to her about how I get rejected every day. And she said, what? And I said, I get rejected literally all the time. And I said, you know, that's just how it goes, because I'm always interested in trying new things, trying different things. And I've just, you know, especially in this business, you have to be prepared to not always hear the word yes, but you know, you're never going to hear the word yes until you put yourself out there and try it. So I think that when I was a very first newbie author, like before I had really had much experience in the business, I just kind of thought, once you wrote a book and it came out, you know, you had made it. You know, there's never a, oh, you've made it. That's just a falsehood completely. It's, you know, every project is starting over again and starting new and starting something different. And some of the things that you do are going to be more successful than other things. And especially in entertainment and movies and writing.
Oh, absolutely.
I don't think there's such thing as a career trajectory that just goes like a straight line. It's more like a wavy line that hopefully is heading in the right direction.
The right directions, right.
Yeah. So that I didn't understand that, you know, when I first started out. But, you know, actually I kind of like it that it's that way now, because this is what I always tell people that are having a hard time in their career. And it was kind of like I was saying when Unleashing Mr. Darcy the book came out. You know, I was hoping that was going to be my big huge splash, you know, in the literary world. And when it kind of came out and sales were modest, you know, I just
disappointed.
And I felt bad. I thought I was a disappointment to my agent and a disappointment to all the people who had worked on it. And, but you know, look what happened. I mean, we totally turned that situation around. And once you have experienced a disappointment in your creative career and you've bounced back and then had a, you know, a success following it, to me, that's really empowering, because I know that if I try something and it doesn't work out that well, that's not the end of the story. I can turn things around because I did it once and I can do it again. And to me, that's empowering. So
it is. Yeah. And I think so many people, I've talked with people that had great successes and maybe they've had two or three and they're the ones that get hurt the hardest because they do a trajectory that you think, but when they crash, they don't know what to do. They think it's the end of the world. Well, I would rather as well have this kind. And so you go up and down and the same happened. And everyone, like with The Christmas Prince, I mean, no one had any idea that that movie was going to blow up and be like the second most watched Netflix movie ever. Oh, you know, God. That was never. And you know, the backstory to that was written for Hallmark. Mm-hmm. That's where I thought it was going. You know, that's of course, you know, now I've learned Hollywood, there's so many different balls in the air, but that's where I thought it was going. And when it ended up on Netflix as their first original Christmas movie, no one had any idea of all of the things that happened, but nobody knew my backstory of the journey because honestly, I had always wanted to write a Hallmark movie. And while it was that weird double-edged sword when I was so excited when I thought it was going to be a Hallmark movie. And when I heard, you know, my agent calls and says Netflix, of course it's Netflix. Hello. But the other part of me was sad. I was like, wait, what happened to Hallmark? You know, I was really bummed because I'd written it in that lane. And obviously Netflix needs a whole different style, you know, a whole different way. But I do remember everyone just assuming because I hadn't broken in. It was my first movie. I was not a published author. I was for nonfiction for my travel therapy. It's called Travel Therapy, Where Do You Need to Go? And went with my travel show. But I'd wanted to break into fiction for so long. And it's so hard as a romance. You know, this was before you could self-pub. I'm talking 10 years ago. And rom-coms disappeared like in around 2008. The movies I love to watch, you know, all of those great Hugh Grant, Julia Roberts, you know, Meg Ryan movies sort of disappeared. And I've been waiting. So I love that advice because I feel like, same with me, I tell people every day that I have had the hardest hardships. Two of the screenplays that I wrote after Christmas Camp and Finding Christmas, I wrote because I had to have surgeries and I couldn't travel for my travel show. And I don't share that a lot of what happened and what was going on. But I wrote because I couldn't do anything for 2 weeks. And I thought, well, what am I going to do? I can write. I have a chance. I can do something. And I just think that that's important because it's not easy, no matter who you're watching, me, Teri, anyone out there. But you got to keep trying. And I get no every day too, Teri, every single day. I mean, no. I actually like it. I say I use no as fuel. It actually gives me a little boost to go keep going. You know, I mean,
it makes me want it more.
Yes. And it almost, isn't it true that when someone says yes too fast, I'm suspicious. I'm like, oh, that can't be right. Why are they saying yes to me? You know, I'm like, wait a minute. Where's the struggle? Where's this? So love that tip. I think it's so important. If you're watching up there, it's okay. You're going to hit it and never settle. Just because I did A Christmas Prince, it didn't mean I could sit back. It actually gave me more pressure. What do you got next? How are you going to top that one? And when I did the 5 movies and the 4 novels in 3 years, which even when I put up that graphic, I it's even hard for me. It just doesn't make sense. I'm constantly trying to elevate it and bring it every day. And I feel the pressure. Like I have to make it special. I have for my audience and for the people that are following and been so kind. I just feel like you never make it. And I think that's okay. You want to grow and you want to be real with people and you want to share. And that's what this show is about. You know, before people see just the social posts that look fabulous, I want to tell people it's hard. It's been a struggle. You know, it's super hard, but that leads me to your next tip, which I think is so important. And Jeff Fisher, the director of Christmas Camp, said something similar. It is such a hard industry, especially the entertainment side. If you're going to do it, you better love it and you better be true to your story and love what you write. Don't try to chase the next movie thinking you can sell it because it's popular. So tell me about that.
Right. Well, that is it. I really, really believe in that hard. Yeah. You know, writing a book is difficult. You know, it seems like such a great shiny new idea at first, but you know, then when you're on a deadline and you have to get it done fast and then you get to the middle and you're just like, oh my gosh, it would be so much easier just to write something new and start over again. You know, you need to be in love with your story. You need to be really happy and excited to work on it, you know, even when it's hard. And I guess what I'm trying to say is don't chase trends. You know, don't think, oh, vampires are super popular. I'm going to write a vampire book. You know, well, first of all, what happens if your vampire book is just like a huge, gigantic success? Every single publisher who wants to work with you is going to ask you to write vampires again. And if you did it because you were chasing a trend, hello, now you have a vampire career, you know?
Right, exactly.
So, right. And so I just think it's really, really important to write what you love, because if that's what you're going to be spending your time doing,
exactly.
And I also think that if you love it, if your heart is in it, it's going to be better. That's just how I feel about it. You know, I love rom-coms, like you were saying. I mean,
yeah.
Even when rom-coms disappeared, I mean, I just rewatched them over and over again.
Me too.
Like the other day, you know, because Christmas Charms is out with reviewers, you know, who are reading an early copy of it.
Yeah.
So I've been seeing, you know, the reviews as they come in, and I saw a review the other day, and the review said, oh, everyone is going to love this charming version of Sweet Home Alabama set at Christmas. And I thought, well, first of all, I love that movie.
Me too, me too.
I didn't write a Sweet Home Alabama story set at Christmas, and I thought about it, and I was like, oh my gosh, I totally did. It is Sweet Home Alabama.
And that's, I love that. I love that our readers can pick up on that. And that leads me to your next tip, which I love, which is dream big and believe, and always believe. So tell me about that, because you better hold that belief in your heart. And I think all of us that write Christmas, we believe, right? That's what we do.
Yes. I mean, yes. I mean, you know, I wanted to write a Christmas book for Hallmark. And that's, you know, when I wrote the proposal for Christmas Charms. And talk about tenacious and hearing no. Yeah. I mean, that proposal went through 7 rounds of revisions over 9 months before I sold that book. And, you know, I think a lot of people would just give up after 1 or 2. I'm not trying to make myself sound maybe, but I mean, I think, especially if you're a writer, because so many writers have self-doubt already, that the easy thing to do would be like, okay, I tried, I didn't. But, you know, I was like, no, I'm going to make it work. With every single round of feedback I got, I was like, I'm going to make this be, you know, the best it can be, and how it will fit best for Hallmark. And I just think you need to believe in it. If there's something that you want really badly, I'm just a big believer in manifesting, you know, visualizing it happening and knowing in your heart that you're just going to keep trying and keep trying and keep working toward it. And then one day it's going to happen.
I believe that 100%, Teri. And that's why you've been so successful. And I can't thank you enough for being with us. And I want to make sure that we show everyone how to follow your journey, because there's so much coming up. And we know there's going to be more movies in the making and so many projects that we're hopefully we'll have you back on where you can share, because there's so much to go over. We need to do a masterclass just on writing and so many things. And there's our little sweetie. Look at how cute. She wins for best puppy on my show, because you've had her for the whole hour. I am amazed by her. She's amazing. So where can we find you, Teri? Where can we find you? Where's the best place to go to see your books and to follow you on social?
Okay. Well, my website is teriwilson.net, TeriWilson.net. And it has links to all of my socials. So I'm on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, and on Goodreads. I think Instagram is my favorite. And my account is Teri Wilson Author, TeriWilson Author. On Twitter, I do tweet a lot, because Hallmark has a big Twitter community. And so I like to talk to the Hallmark fans. Oh, look, now she's getting wiggly because you said she was.
Oh, that's good. I go, no, she is good. She is good.
And so on Twitter, I'm Teri Wilson Author, but without the O in author, because that was too long. Yes. And Facebook, same thing, Teri Wilson Author. So if you just put in Teri Wilson Author, you know, I'm sure I'll show up pretty much everywhere. So.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to put up both of you.
I share a lot of puppy pictures. I share a lot of, you know, book things and just, you know, funny things about my everyday life. I love fashion. So I always post a lot of stuff about that. And I love the royal family. So
I know. Oh, my goodness. We're going to have you on and do so much more about that, because that's why I follow you. I have so many great things. I can't thank you enough for being on. And I want to put up Teri's books one more time. But these two books are coming out for Christmas, you guys. This is what you want to be able to find for your stocking stuffers. And please go to Teri's website, because there's so many different stories that she has, and there's so many great things. And honestly, Teri, thank you from the bottom of my heart for sharing your tips, just for being kind and being the kind of author that we all love, and for giving us these Hallmark movies that are truly some of the closest to my heart. So it's just your kindness, your love, and your compassion.
Thank you so much.
So inspired by you. So I want to thank everybody for watching this edition of Christmas Karen Behind the Story. We all wish you the happiest of holidays. You can follow my journey at KarenShaler.com, and you know where to find me on social. So I look forward to seeing everybody. And Teri, happy holidays. And everyone, thanks for joining us. We'll see you soon. Bye.
Thank you.